Good evening, everyone. I hope that you had a nice Sunday afternoon and a nice day thus far. We're happy to see you. We have visitors with us, as we typically do, but we have visitors related to me, literally related to me. Lauren's mother and her great aunt, Melinda, her mother and her great aunt. Well, we just call her Baby, but you might just call her Miss Colson. That's all right, too. But they are visiting with us because we are going to Lubbock, Lauren and I, tomorrow and Tuesday. We'll be driving there, and just enough time for me to speak on Tuesday afternoon, a lectureship, and then we'll turn right around to get back in time for me to teach class on Wednesday. So they're going to babysit for us, not babies, they're not babies anymore. They're going to child growing up too fast to sit for us while we're away, so I'm sure that's not going to be too much of a burden for the grandmother and great aunt. So we're happy they're with us. Make sure you see them and say hello to them. We have been considering all year on the first Sunday of the year, Sunday night of the year, the Psalms. And since there are simply just too many to consider, there's 150 of those beautiful bits of poetry in your Bible. We're considering just the 12 of my favorites. And we're noticing some periodically on a Sunday morning sermon as well. We'll do that here in a couple of Sunday mornings. But mostly we just cannot get all of them in. So we'll probably revisit this series in a few years, looking at the Psalms again. But it is, I hope it has been and continues to be a worthwhile study, these Psalms, these condensed little bits of the wisdom of God and the praise men bring to God, these 150 individual poems. It's an interesting book. It's a unique book. In fact, the most unique book, perhaps, in your Bible, especially since it's not like every other book, which has a narrative, not a story like a made-up story, but every book that you read has some beginning, middle, and ending to them. Even if it's a letter like Romans, that the author will make his case, his argument. He'll make his arguments of what he's arguing, and then he'll restate his arguments in his conclusion. There's an obvious beginning, middle, and ending. The Psalms aren't like that. In fact, it's technically incorrect to say Psalms chapter 12 or Psalms chapter 23 because they're not chapters. It's not a book. It doesn't work that way. They're individual psalms. And so we've been considering Psalm 1 on the first Sunday of the beginning of the year. We considered Psalm 23. We considered Psalm 22 and so on and so on. Now we turn our attention to Psalm 30, the 30th one, the background to which is very vague. We don't have a whole lot of information within the text or from other Bible verses about this psalm so that we could put together the picture to know why and when and where David, the author, wrote this psalm. Nevertheless, we know David wrote it, but the circumstances of it we're not certain of. Your Bible might say at the beginning of it was written at the dedication of David's house, but that was added centuries later by people who just assumed that's what the psalm was written about. That part written there wasn't inspired by the Holy Spirit, so take it with a grain of salt, if you will. But each psalm, as we're going to notice, this one is very particular, has a very particular theme behind it. But each of the psalms that we've noticed, and the others we haven't gotten around to, have its own individual theme. Some psalms are cries to God for help. Some psalms are, the individual writing it is dealing with the confidence that God will help. And some psalms simply say, God, I thank you that you have help. Psalm 30 is one of those psalms. This isn't a text that says, please God, dot, dot, dot. This isn't a text that says, God will, dot, dot, dot. This is a text that says, God has, dot, dot, dot. And we'll notice what that dot, dot, dot is the rest of the psalm. This is a psalm that speaks to the confidence, yes, but that's after the fact. The assurance, yes, but it's after the fact. This psalm deals with the looking at what God has done for me and why I should be thankful that God has been so good to me. Now, we were talking about Thanksgiving this morning, how thankful we are, how much we've slowly and steadily grown here. It's becoming Thanksgiving time here in just a few weeks. This is a good, important psalm to study around this time of the year. Jesse was talking about we don't observe holidays in a religious sense, except for Sunday, that's our holy day. Nevertheless, we have these secular days that we set aside on our calendar, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's Romans 13. One of which is coming up quickly is Thanksgiving. Well, this is a psalm about Thanksgiving, but it's not just about Thanksgiving. The reason that David is thankful is because David sinned. This psalm starts, after the opening statement, with a sour note. I was sinful, but God forgave me. And if you don't have that, but God forgave me, it's a very sad psalm. But it's because God was willing and able to forgive David, he writes this psalm of praise and thanks to God. Has God ever, have you ever sinned before God? Have you repented of those sins? Here's a song that can help you to express your ideas and your appreciation to God when you offer a prayer of thanksgiving for God when He forgives you of your sins. You know, sometimes we think, I've sinned, I'll say my prayer of repentance and then just go on my way. How about after you say the prayer of repentance, Christian, you then offer a prayer of thanksgiving that God forgave you? That's Psalm 30. There are five divisions, if you will, to this psalm that we're going to notice as we divide it up. It's a short, simple study of a short, simple psalm, but it's broken into five parts. They are simply this. This psalm teaches us about David's perception. It teaches us David's praise. It teaches us David's presumption. Then there's David's prayer, followed by David's peace. You get those five down and you'll understand Psalm 30. Let's start with the first three verses and David's perception. Notice Psalm 30, verses 1 through 3. I will, the King James says, extol thee, O Lord, for thou hast lifted me up and hast not made my foes to rejoice over me. O Lord my God, I cried unto thee, and thou hast healed me. See the past tense? O Lord, thou hast brought up my soul from the grave. Thou hast kept me alive that I should not go down into the pit. Notice the very first statement made by the psalmist. It's actually a play on words. If you're looking at it as I am in the King James, it doesn't really come through. He says a word which only appears four times in your entire Bible, three of which appear in the 150 Psalms. It is the word extol. The word extol means to lift up. Now, you see the play on words? You think you do. You probably think, oh, I see it. He says, God, I will lift you up. And then it follows with, because you have lifted me up. Oh, there's the play on words. But that's not the play on words. You're right. David is saying, God, I will lift you up. Literally, I will place you on a higher place. That's a song we sometimes sing. We place you on the highest place, for you are the great high priest. That's what David is saying. But the second part of that, because you have lifted me up, it's one word in the Hebrew. And it means, if it's used in the negative, to let someone down. But it's not used here in the negative. You have not let me down, David says. Now you see the play on words? God, I will lift you up. Why? Because you have not let me down. You see a beautiful bit of poetry there. God, I will ever rejoice because when I was down and out, you picked me up. You did not leave me down and out. You did not let me stay down. You lifted me up. You didn't leave me down and out. The origin of the phrase, in fact, involves drawing water from a well. So now picture that. You have a bucket tied to a rope on a pulley system. You lower the bucket into the water. It fills with water. Then what do? You don't leave it there. Then you rise it up. David is saying, I'm slowly being weighted down by my problems, but God, you did not leave me down. You, with the pulley, raised me up. So David perceives how God has always been, is presently now, and shall ever be his lifter-upper, his one to get him through, his one to see him through all of his problems. You didn't let me stay down. You didn't let, finish the first verse, my enemies to rejoice over me. You didn't leave me down because that would have given my enemies, David says, which are your enemies, God, an opportunity to point and shake their fingers at you and say, look at God's servant being defeated. God's servants aren't defeated. Oh, they have moments of losing a battle, perhaps, but the victory belongs to God. Are you on God's side? David says, you didn't leave me down and out. Otherwise, my enemies would have said, you call this a servant of God? This is the God that you follow, the Philistines might say, the Ammonites might say. No, you didn't leave me down and out. You didn't give my enemies a reason to, the word rejoice means, to be brightened up. You didn't give them a chance to smile at my expense. Verse 2, he says, I cried unto thee, literally, to your side. I cried running to your side. Picture it now. Close your eyes and visualize it. If you're a mother, you don't have to close your eyes. It probably happened to you today. A screaming, crying child, what do? Who do they want? They don't want daddy. Daddy stands there, come here. They run around because they're looking for mom. They want that mother. They want that tender affection. Listen, my Father in heaven provides that tender affection. David says, when I was down, you didn't leave me down and out. I was crying to you and I ran to your side. And you put your arm around me and helped you. Someone asks sometimes, a skeptic, a critic, if you will, why do you Christians pray? David gives you the answer, because prayer is answered. Why do you Christians pray to God? Because God answers prayer. Maybe not the way we wish He would. Maybe not as soon as we would like Him to. Sometimes not with the answer we want it to be. But when we cry to the Lord, He will run us to His side. And He will heal us. Now look again at the beginning of verse 3. You have brought up my soul. Same root word from extol in verse 1, except it's used differently here. You didn't leave me down and out, he says in verse 3. Except here he says, you pulled me up. Now, out of the grave, he says. In verse 1, the visual is of a bucket in a well. Here it's of the person, David himself, in the grave. I was this close to death, but you didn't let me fall. I was this close to falling into the grave, into the pit of despair, but you didn't let me go that far. Now, don't know. Is he speaking literally? David certainly had many occasions when he was near death in a literal physical sense. Or is he just speaking with hyperbole? Is he just saying how great God's always been there to the point where he was near death but God pulled him out? And I don't know. It doesn't really matter. And in fact, I'm happy that it's kind of vague because we've all had our bad circumstances. Because it's vague, you can easily insert yours here. You can mimic the words of David with your own circumstances here. When you are that close to being in your personal grave, God pulls you up and pulls you out. What David's doing here is he is perceiving how God's always been there, how God is there, how God will ever be there. Now that causes him to, number two, look at verse 4 and 5, David's praise. Sing unto the Lord, he commands, speaking outwardly, O ye saints of his, give thanks at the remembrance of his holiness, for his anger endures but for a moment. In his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Now, you see how the psalm changes from introspection, I, me. You didn't help. You helped me. You didn't leave me down. You didn't leave me alone. To outward reflection. He says, after the first three verses, if he had just cut off with verse 3, this psalm is a lot like Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. He leads me beside still waters. But here, he turns it. As the king commands his people, now look at what God's done for me. Find something he's done for you and rejoice. Sing to the Lord, O ye saints of his, O ye godly people of his possession. Give thanks at the, my Bible says, remembrance. The word is originally at the memento. Not at the thought. At the thing which springs the thought. Whenever you have some bad circumstance, everybody, think about it. It's going to be different for everybody, so keep it in your brain. There's been something, more than likely, there's been hundreds of them, but there's been something in particular that you can think of that God has done to help you. Think about it. What is it? Right now, I'll give you 2 seconds. Have you got it? Now that, whatever it is a memento. It's something which sparks the memory. It sparks a reminder, and you say to yourself, God was there for me then. Now, if you keep that there, it is like a light that burns that no one can blow out. What kept Paul going when he was in prison? This right here. A memento, a reminder that sparked a memory. God's always been there. God is there. God will be there. You've been there. So he says to you, people, the king commands us, sing to the people. Sing all ye people, rather, to the Lord. Remember that he's been good for you. Find some of that real tangible proof that God is there. You know, the skeptics will try to water down what your faith is and say, you people just live off a wing and a prayer. You people just walk based the way they need to walk by faith. Like, you have no evidence that God does anything for you. You just hope that he will someday. No. No, I don't hope that someday God will do something for me. I have real, tangible evidence. I've experienced things. I've seen things. Things have happened by God's providence that tell me, that prove to me, God's on my side. Correction? That I'm on God's side. So I don't need to just go by a wing and a prayer, as they phrase it, to walk by faith the way they mean it. No, I know God's on my side, that I'm on God's side. I have mementos, little things I can think about, point to, and remember, God was with me. Now look at verse 5. Look at this beautiful poetry. He's saying in verse 4, to the people, come rejoice, for God is a good God. He answers prayer and helps. But someone might say, but David, look at me and my problems. What reason have I got to rejoice? Oh, sure, you people who are doing okay, yeah, by all means be happy. But I've got problems. I've got reasons to be mad at God, not to rejoice to God. But David says those problems are like that. Your bad days are gone with the sunset. A new day dawns when a new sun rises. You've got reason to rejoice constantly. Your bad days are but for a moment, literally a week. Here at God, just like that. You see David's perception, God has helped. You see David's praise, God is good. Now what's the reason behind the psalm? It was David's presumption. Look at verses 6 and 7. And in my prosperity, I said, if he had suspenders, he'd pop them. I shall never be moved. Lord, by thy favor, thou hast made my mountain to stand strong. Thou didst hide my face, and I was, my bowels is troubled. The word means trembled. David, why are you writing this song? Because there was a time when I said, look how awesome I am. And he popped his suspenders. I shall not be moved. David recalls a time when his relationship with God got a little rocky. He sinned. What it was, it could have been a huge, humongous thing. It could have been just a flash of anger in one moment of one day. Whatever the sin was, however long it lasted, there was a sin that David committed, and God rebuked him, and he prays to God for help, and God forgives him. But you see his presumption there in verse 6? I shall not be moved. That's a statement of arrogance. I'm okay. I don't need help. I don't need God. 1 Corinthians 10:12. Let him that thinks he stands alone, the implication is, take heed lest he fall. Alone. You say you don't need God? See what happens when you don't have God. You'll fall down very hard, very fast. So David messes up. Verse 7, he forgot that it was God who provided all the things that he had, that he was boasting. Look at me and all that I've accomplished. Yes, well, who gave me the talent to accomplish that? Someone says, the farmer says, look at the crop I've harvested. He boasts. Well, who gave you the crop? I did. I planted those grains. Well, who gave you the seed? I did. I harvested the seed. Well, who gave you the rain which sprouted up the seed? Arrogance. God gets the credit. David forgot that for a moment. And he says he was troubled. He trembled when God rebuked him. Which leads him to verses 8 through 10. David's prayer. He says, I cried to thee, O Lord, and unto the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Shall the dust praise thee? Shall I declare thy truth? Hear, O Lord, and have mercy upon me. Lord, be thou my helper. Awesome contrast, we'll see it in a moment, between look what I did versus Lord, be my helper. Notice, though, what David doesn't do when the Lord blesses him. David forgets about God and God rebukes him. You know what he doesn't do? He doesn't dig in his heels like so many do. He doesn't just dig in his heels and reject God more. He falls and humbles himself. How many times, though, over and over, God blesses and blesses and blesses, and that person forgets who it was from, capital W, who it was from, who gave him the blessings, and so the blessings stop. And suddenly the person remembers, oh yeah, God. And he says, God, you stopped blessing me. And God says, well, you stopped thanking me. Well, you're not going to bless me anymore then. How is that helping you any? So he says, I cried. I called out, literally. He made supplication, literally. He stooped down. That's a visual of his prayer. Falls on his knees, falls on his face. And he falls prostrate before God. And then look at the turnaround. Verse 9, he says, God, please don't punish me. Don't kill me, God. If I die, if I'm just dust again, how can I praise you again? If I'm just reduced to dust and a grave, how can a grave sing praises to your name? Verse 6, remember, I shall never be moved. Then he says in verse 10, Lord, be my helper, literally be my protector. In verse 6, when he's being arrogant and presumptuous, it's all about me, I can do it. And now when he's humble, he has the right attitude. God, I need your help, I can't do it. Finally, he brings him to verse 11 and 12, David's peace. What does he say? You have turned from me my mourning into dancing. You have put off my sackcloth and girded me with gladness. To the end of my glory may sing praise to thee and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks to thee forever and forever and forever. It's written as a forever statement. He could have kept writing the words forever and forever. I'll never stop now. So look at the text as we've outlined it. You have David's opening statement, his perception. God has helped. Why? What does he do? In light of that, he praises. God is good. That's followed by some context. Why is he writing the song? Because of his presumption. I have rejected. Which led him to his prayer. I offered supplication. I repented. And so we come full circle. Because God forgave, he has peace. Children of God, listen to me. The moment you sin and don't repent, The time period between your sinning and not repenting is a time period when you are outside of fellowship with God. But the split second, the exact half moment that you repent, you're forgiven. That's walking in the light, 1 John 1:7. The time period between your sin and your failure to repent, whether it's out of arrogance or ignorance or whatever it is, that is outside of the fellowship with God. And you're in the exact same boat as every person who never even heard the gospel or obeyed it. But the split second, look at the privilege you have as a child of God, the exact split second you repent, as David does, it's all forgiven. It's all over. People hold things over their head, over your head. People will use your mistakes and blackmail you. Never God is forgiven and forgotten. Tears turn to triumph, David says. My mourning turns to repentance. My sorrow turns to dancing and rejoicing. Sighing turns to song. Look how carefully he chooses his words. Look down at it again. You took off my sackcloth. You girded me with gladness. He could have easily said it. No one would have thought twice about it. I took off my sackcloth, which was the clothing you put on for others to see. This person is in mourning. This person is sorrowing over something. When I've sinned and I'm repenting and I feel sorrowful, I put on sackcloth. Job did in sackcloth and ashes because he didn't know why he was being tormented and persecuted. David says, I put on sackcloth, but you took it off. I didn't take it off. You did. Why? Because God tends to forgive me faster than I forgive myself. I sometimes hold it over my head longer when God has said it's forgotten and forgiven. You girded me with gladness when I was still sorrowing in my sin. That's the middle of the psalm. You told me to smile again. So he concludes verse 12 with the Hebrew expression, I will sing praise and give thanks to God forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. The entire timeline of David's sin, rejection by God, repentance to God, and forgiveness from God. That whole thing could have taken the span of 2 minutes. It could have, however, been 2 months. Who knows? But the result is, God forgave me. God, therefore, deserves a lifetime of thanksgiving. Because God doesn't have to forgive me at all. Listen to me, and then I'm done. God does not have to forgive me at all. But if God forgives at all, God forgives it all. So we give thanks. What about you? Are you thankful that you're forgiven? Are you forgiven? Are you a child of God? Are you a faithful child of God? Is there some sin that is now separating you from your Father in heaven? Repent of that sin as David does. Be forgiven by God as David was. And sing praises to God and thanksgiving to Him again. If we can help you in any way, let us know how right now as we stand and sing.